Okay, welcome everybody. My name is Peter van Ooyen. I'm working at DASH, the Data Science Center in Health. And I want to welcome you all to this first webinar of DASH, Introduction to Data Science for Analysts. Currently we have about 36 people or 63 people already as participants, and some people are still trying to connect. So we have about 12 people that are trying to get in. So we hope that they will also be able to connect into the webinar. To start, I want to give you a short introduction of DASH and what DASH does. That's here on the slide. You should see the slides now. DASH is the Data Science Center. It's a central unit in the UMCG, so we are not connected to any specific department. It's a group of people that are coming from different departments and have joined DASH as part-timers to increase the knowledge and the use of data science within the UMCG. To do that, we have a couple of different things we do. We run DASH projects together with all kinds of different departments where we try to increase the use of data science and help people to do data science. We work on community building. We collaborate with external parties in the incubator. We look for funding opportunities to get extra funding for DASH itself, but also help other people to write work packages on data science, for example, for funding proposals. We have the machine learning lab, which I'm heading. So there we do the actual research in machine learning with all kinds of different projects in different departments on different types of data. We look at needs assessment. We look at education, and these webinars and our DASH Sparkle events are part of that. And we try to work on the communication both within the UMCG and outside of the UMCG on what we do in our organization on data science. Today's webinar is organized together with André Capello, who's also online analyst at the UMCG. So he came to DASH with his need. We want to have some kind of lectures or information sharing for analysts to learn more about AI, data science, etc. And he wanted to form a group of analysts that are interested in working with data science and AI. So this is basically the kickoff for that. Now for the setup itself of this evening, you can always ask questions in between. You can either type a question into the chat box to the right of your screen. You can open that by the purple button, and you can type in your questions. We will look at those questions and we will try to answer them. You can also raise your hand by the button in the middle of the screen, the bottom middle. You can raise your hand, and we can give you the floor. You can turn on your microphone and tell us what your question or remark is. Outside of that, please turn off your microphone so we don't have any noise covering the speaker. So we only hear the speaker and not everything else. If you prefer, you can also ask your questions in Dutch. Then we will translate them because we do have some people that do not understand or speak Dutch, so we want to translate everything. For today's introduction to data science for analysts, we have two speakers. First, we will have Wienand Alkema. He is lecturer data science for life science and health at the Hanse University. He will give a general introduction to data science, followed by three use cases, and afterwards, Mark Veldkamp, product manager at the IT Academy Noord-Nederland, will lead a more interactive part around what analysts need to apply data science in their day-to-day work. And you will have the opportunity to share your ideas on this with group as well. Like I said before, that can be either by raising your hand and we'll give you the chance to talk, or you type in your remarks through the chat box. I see still people are trying to get in. We're now almost 80 participants here. So I think it's a very nice group of people to have together here this evening. And I would like to invite Wynand to start his introduction to data science.
Yeah, thank you, Peter. I will share my screen so that everybody can see the presentation. Let me see. So does everybody see the first slide that says introduction to, well, nobody is I hope that is visible, otherwise say something in the chat box. I will assume that that my first slide is visible for everybody. And yeah, before starting my presentation, I want to just say that I'm very happy to give this introduction to data science to such a large group, and I think also really a good group to introduce data science to, because also in my own previous past, I've been working at a university medical hospital, and there's so much data around there that can be used to such a great extent to make a difference in patient care and also in research in the biomedical field, that I really enjoy giving this introduction to this group of people. And like Peter already said, I want to give a short introduction of around 10 slides or so, what it means, what we mean, what I mean with data science, because it's a very broad subject and a lot of people have different thoughts with data science. And after that, I will present two or three, dependent on the time, use cases that I've been working on myself and that are from the biomedical domain and really involves real-world patient data, real-world clinical data. And I try to keep this this introduction to about 35 minutes, after which Mark will take over with the rest of the session. And yeah, I want to say I've tried to, this is a large audience, so I've tried to keep it very broad and not to go into too much technical detail. There's always room for follow-up discussions later on if you want to know more about the specific details. And for now, I want to give a broad introduction. Okay. The second slide, it says the domain of data science. And I think that there's lots of graphics out there on the internet that tell you, in fact, how many data we are producing and consuming every day, every hour, every minute. And on the left-hand side, there's a little pie chart that gives some statistics there. I'm not going through all of them. But let's say the top one there, we have 19 million WhatsApp messages every minute being sent. And I think 19 million is not a lot, but realizing that this is every minute, it really makes up for a lot of data. And this is only for WhatsApp. Well, there's lots of data sources. Here we list social media. I will come back to more detail on biomedical data in this respect. But we really have a huge amount of data being produced every day, every minute. And this is the domain of data science, big data, data that are produced at a large scale. And on the right-hand side, we see two word clouds, which is already an interesting visualization, I would say, that a lot of data science people make use of. But these word clouds tell us a little bit on what data scientists use to work with these data. So the top cloud says, in fact, we use machine learning, we use mathematics, Python and R are very important languages for data scientists. They are computing languages, and you have to write programs in these languages to handle your data. So that is a bit of the tools for the data scientist. And on the top, the bottom word cloud, we see a kind of representation of what data scientists do with those tools. And a lot of people talk about AI, machine learning, maybe you've heard of those terms. And big data terms there as well. That is very hot these days, deep learning, artificial intelligence, very important, but data science is more than that. It before you can even go to machine learning, you really have to do a lot of preliminary steps to get your data in good shape. Well, I want to tell today a little bit on what it takes to become or make your first steps into a data scientist and how that applies to biomedical problems, clinical data that you have in practice. So if we look at the biomedical domain, so this is my next slide, big data for medicine and patient care. If we look at this slide, we already dive a little bit more into the medical domain. And is this my, somebody is opening his mic. It's not my computer, I think. So one very famous machine learning application is Dr. Watson. It's a supercomputer developed by IBM. And this Dr. Watson is able to read all the scientific articles that are out there. Think about PubMed. And in that way, mine those data and assist doctors and patients in making decisions. And I think it's really about helping. The computer can help. Big data analysis can help a doctor, can help patients, can help researchers. Also exemplified by the right gimmick. It's still the case that a computer cannot take over what the doctor or a physician is doing. And I foresee that this will not be possible anyway in the foreseeable future. So it's going together. The computer can help taking a lot of work from the patients, from the doctors, from the patients, and helping decision making. And this is where we are going to focus on a little bit in the remainder of the talk. So if we think about biomedical data science, so we dive in a little bit more now into the topic of today, and also I hope to some data sources and techniques and data types that you encounter in your daily work. And that's a bit simplified in this slide, otherwise it gets too crowded. I'm not going through all of this here, but we have a lot of different types of data. On the right-hand side, for example, sequences. We do a lot with genome sequences of patients and healthy people in biomedical data science. Imaging is important. But we also make use a lot of external databases, databases that are collected in the outside world, external world, that contain a lot of data. For example, PubMed is a biomedical papers, a database of biomedical papers. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with PubMed. And there we have, I think, 5 papers produced every minute. And that goes on every minute, every day, every year. So a lot of data also being produced there. And what is also very important these days, and you hear that a lot, is the on the right-hand side, the omics techniques. Omics stands for, how can I say it? Measuring it all. The ohm is meaning all. So we measure the entire genome or the entire transcriptome or proteome of patients or animals for that matter. And also more recently, microbiomics, where we measure, for example, all the microbes that are present in your gut or on your skin. So a lot of techniques, a lot of data being produced also in the biomedical data area. And this is what we work with daily. So this is what we get on the desk, what we get on our hard disk, where we have to deal with. And the data stream is large, and we have to be quick and agile in using the data stream to make decisions. So this is a bit of the world, the data world that we live in, the biomedical data that are being generated. And in the next slides, I want to briefly touch upon what does it take for you, or for people in general, but for analysts to deal with these data? What are the skills that you need? And in fact, there are three very important skills, and I have the following three slides detailing those skills. So the first skill, the first thing that you need to be able to do, so this is how to become a data scientist, step one. And it says hacking and coding skills. Hacking, I have placed between quotation marks because we really don't want to give the idea that hacking and doing unlawful things is good. Hacking in this case, the original term, means being able to write your own code, to write your own software and to tweak it really according to your own needs. So you have to be able to use the standard software programs, but sometimes you really need, as we say it, write a dirty hack to get something done. So it's that's what we mean by hacking. You have to be able to code the things that you want to code. So hacking and coding skills. And on the bottom here are two symbols of languages, because we code in certain languages, we give instructions to the computer on what to do. And the most used languages nowadays by data scientists are either Python, so the left-hand side is the symbol for Python, or R, which is a more statistically oriented program. It's R, and that's the name of the language. And either one of those languages you have to master at least to some degree in order to be able to do what you want with the data. So you need to go from Excel to your coding skills in order to handle these large amounts of data that cannot be handled by ordinary software. This on the right hand side on the top, well, it's hard to read, that's not the problem, but this is just plain text. And this is a little R program. So in text, you write down what you think the computer should do. It's a set of instructions that you tell the computer. The computer executes it and it produces the graphs. One of them is shown here at the right hand side. And so you have to, one of these languages you have to learn to some degree in order to be able to do this. And in that respect, Python is considered a bit more easy than R because it's a little bit more human-friendly if you read it. But people are still debating what the best language is. Well, pick one and work with it. They both are really very good. Okay, so this is part one, the coding, the hacking skills. The second important skill, and that is maybe the hardest one, is that you have to I don't want to say proficient, because I'm also not proficient in there, but you have to have some knowledge about statistics and mathematical transformations. So you have to be, what can I say? You have to know here's a normal distribution given in the middle graph, and you see the sigmas here that indicate how far away you are from the mean. You have to be able to grasp these concepts a little bit and also know what it means if you are three standard deviations away from the mean. Also related to that is the t-test over here. You have to be able to at least understand the concept behind these formulas. You don't have to calculate with them, because that's all done by the statistics in these programs, but you have to know when do I use a t-test, when do I use another test, etc. So you really have to have a bit of knowledge about this area, the math. In my experience, you don't have to start here because this is a very broad subject. But once you are in your own data space and you have your own data problems, you really also should dive into the math and statistics that really relevant for your data set. And so that is it's something that should not be neglected. I will come back to that a little bit later on what can happen there. Okay, so we have had the coding skills, the statistics. The third part is also very important. And this is what we call domain knowledge. And given this audience, a lot of people have domain knowledge. But what we mean by this, and you have that, is that you have to know a little bit about the system that you're working on. You have to know what a gene is, what a protein is, what the pathway is, or you have to know what the tumor cell is. Otherwise, the data that you're generating do not make sense. And you can also not judge whether what you get out of your analysis really does make biological sense. If we have a gene expression that has a negative value, that doesn't make sense. Whereas a negative temperature does make sense. So you have to know the biological, the medical problem that you're working on, which is a bit exemplified by the lower three images. Yeah? So the molecular stuff, the cellular stuff over here, but also on the right-hand side, how it works out on a human scale, on a physiological scale. And even there, you also have to realize mice are not humans. So that is also a translation that you need to make. So you have to have that domain knowledge. And I think also for analysts is also very important that you have to have knowledge on the machines that generated your data. So how trustworthy are those machines? What is the type of data that they generate? Are they stable? Do you measure one day something? Is that repeatable the next day? Where are the sources of technical and biological variation? And this cannot be underestimated, the domain knowledge. If you don't have enough domain knowledge, you may end up with biologically irrelevant results in your data science projects. So those are the three factors, the three skill sets that you need to have. And I've summarized this in this graph over here. So here we have I'm now on how to become a data scientist, step 4. That's where we integrate those things. So this is the merging of all those three skills. And of course, nobody has all of those skills in equal amounts. So this is the ideal picture. But nevertheless, you need to have knowledge yourself or your close collaborator of all those three domains. If we don't have, I'm not going to go through all these intersections, only this one. This is interesting. If you are very good at programming and you have some domain knowledge, but you do not apply rigorous statistical tests and mathematical skills, you end up, and we call this the danger zone, and it really is a danger zone. This is not only a funny word, it's really, really present. You end up with false spurious correlations. And I've shown here a graph, which is in fact real data, that shows a very high correlation between the divorce rate, I think it was in the US, but doesn't really matter, and margarine consumption. A really high correlation, but of course we know, probably, that this does not make sense at all. Why would these two variables be related? And for this particular case, it's very easy to spot. I mean, there is no relation there. But suppose you are looking for an hypothesis that says the degree of disease, let's say virus infection on the x-axis and on the y-axis, the expression of a certain gene, of which you thought, it could be related to that gene, to that disease. And so, and then you don't know whether this, I mean, as long as it makes biological sense, you are very tempted to believe such a relation. And this really is in practice, especially when you have large data sets. There is this quote, it's not from myself, it's on the internet, torture the data and it will confess to anything. And it is really a problem when you work with big data. You can always find a relation between something and something else. Think about I guess that it's clear. So this part here, very important as well to really statistically test that. And this is the area of data science where we bring all of those together. So we have a bit of math, a bit of coding, and a bit of domain knowledge, and we apply this to our problems. I assume that there are no questions. Can I, because I can't see the chat box. Otherwise, Mark or Peter, just let me know. Otherwise,
There are some questions, Wienand.
Yeah.
The first one is to the pop-up menu in your screen. Can you hide it?
Oh.
Yeah. And okay. I think now there are a few participants who have questions.
Maybe I can.
No. It was right. What you did was right. So it's good. It's good now.
Oh. So where do I see the questions?
No, they're not. They have okay. to. Is there a question?
Otherwise, people just know.
No. You can okay. continue.
Okay. Good. So I have 15 minutes left for a few use cases. Let's see how it goes. So my first use case is a project we were working on for the pediatric department. So we work with NEO, very small children between the age of 0 and 4. And a big problem is there if those children get infected, they can get infected by a bacterium, or they can get infected by a viral infection. And it's very important to discriminate between those two, because if it's a bacterial infection, you need to give antibiotics, and otherwise you need to give an antiviral treatment. And you really don't want to give those children too many antibiotics. So the question was, can we, using big data, very quickly predict or discriminate children that are infected by bacteria from children that are infected by a viral infection? And the way we did this was by doing a mass spectrometry on the entire complement system as we know it today. I'm not going into detail there what that means, but it's involved in the innate immunity of children and very likely to play a role in the response to a bacteria and a virus. And so we measured from a lot of children with bacterial and viral infection, we measured the levels of the complement system. And so you get a data set for hundreds of children where you also have the levels of hundreds of proteins. This is a big Excel file, a big data file, and it's very hard to at first sight see what are the differences between those children. So a very important technique that is shown on the next slide, and that's why I'm showing it, it's almost always used in data science project, is principal component analysis. This technique was invented, I think, 100 years ago, so it's an old technique, but still very useful. And we use this to discover patterns, and there's a lot of statistics behind that, I'm not going into detail there. But basically what a principal components plot shows you is each child, each patient represented by a single dot in this graph. So we have about 100 dots here. And I apologize for this is not colorblind proof here, but we see here on the right hand side with this statistical technique, we see all the healthy persons. And on the left hand side, we see viral and bacterially infected children. A lot of math beneath that, but the main message from this picture is we can, based on the data, separate healthy from disease, but we can hardly separate, in this case, the bacterial from the viral. Those data from the complement system really cannot discriminate between those two disease states, if you look at the entire data set. This is a very important technique. Maybe you've heard of it. A lot of people use it. They also refer to this with a much, much more difficult term, unsupervised clustering, because we look at clustering in the data, or also multi multivariate statistics because we look at a lot of variables at the same time. But it's a very important technique, and also one that that is almost the starting point of any data science project. What is happening with my data? So we know now already, without looking into detail, we have a difference between healthy and deceased. The other, and that's why I'm showing it, the other technique that that we used on this data set is not looking at the data set as a whole, as I showed for the principal component analysis, but look at each individual protein via box plots. And I will just highlight the one over here, CRP, that is C-reactive protein. It's a very acute phase protein. Once you have an infection, this CRP goes up. And what we see is that we have very high levels of CRP in the bacterially infected children compared to the children that are infected by a virus and compared to the healthy. We see that there's still an overlap between the viral and the bacterial children, but nevertheless, there's a difference here. So these box plots, I don't know how often you use them yourself or how familiar you are with that, but also in these box plots, each dot that I'm pointing here is an individual child, an individual patient. So you will see that in all the patients, the CRP ratio level goes from 500 to about zero. So there's a huge variation also in these children. So a box plot not only gives you the median, but it also tells you something about the range. And that's very important to know what you can expect in those samples. So box plots is a very powerful visualization that is often used to see what's happening in your data. The last slide on this one, this is the most complicated one, and I was wondering whether I should put it in or not, but I did it nevertheless because it details the last step or an important step in data science, and this means going from describing what you see to predicting something, predictive statistics, people call it sometimes. So it's a bit of a complicated slide. Conceptually at least, but what we did in this paper and in this data is saying, can we now, based on the data that we have, the mass spec data of the entire complement system, can we derive or make a model that predicts whether a child is bacterially infected or virally infected? And this is the step where we use the data to predict something. And we predict whether what the type of disease is for that child. And this is where we talk about machine learning, predictive modeling, artificial intelligence. I mean, the system, the computer learns based on the data to predict something new. Yeah, so we make a model and we say, given the data, can we predict the type of disease of a child? And the way we visualize that, so this is also a very important type of visualization in data science, is an ROC curve. And if you are working in diagnostics, you will be familiar with these type of graphs, because it tells you for every test, how many true positives do I have? How many false positives? So people that are children that are predicted to be bacterially but are not really infected, and how many false negatives, and what the trade-off is between that. I'm not going to explain it in more detail, but the higher the area here is under the curve, the better your model is. And here we compared a machine learning model, the black one, which is based on the mass spectrometry data, so proteomics data. We compared that with a measurement based on CRP alone in the assay that's now used in the clinic. And we see that the area under the curve for this black line is a little bit higher than for CRP. Well, whether that translates to a useful clinical assay is really totally a different matter. But I wanted to show this graph nevertheless to say, from the data that you have, you can start to build a model that predicts whether a child is bacterially infected or not. And this is the last step often in a data science project, that you go from descriptive statistics to predictive statistics, as we call it. I'm just looking at the time. I think I will do one use case more, because it's totally different, and then I'll skip the third use case, otherwise Mark will not have enough time. The slides will, I believe, will be sent anyway, so the third use case can always be looked at on the slides. So the last use case, and there has to do with Streptococcus pneumoniae, and this is a pathogen which is causing pneumonia. It's a very invasive disease. But what sometimes happens is that you get also infections of other organs, like your brain or that. So you can get more infections than only in your lungs. And this is really caused by how fast this streptococcus spreads in your body, how fast it is cleared, and how shall I say it? How aggressive it is, the inflicted damage. And there's a lot of studies on pneumococcal strains out there in the world, and people believe that these strains are these three things here, the three bullet points, are related to the growth characteristics of the streptococci. So what we had at a certain point, and this is really a typical, I would say, data science problem as well, because you're dealing really with a lot of data. People collected in the hospital 350 strains of pneumococci and started measuring the growth kinetics in a spectrophotometer. And this was done with duplicate technical replicates and triplicate biological replicates. So you have six data sets per strain, where they measured almost 5,000 points per growth curve. And all those data were delivered in individual Excel files. So you have, lots of Excel files. And then people came to us because it was not, you couldn't handle the data anymore in Excel with so many files, so many data points. And in my opinion, this is a very common situation, that you quickly get so many files that you spend weeks reorganizing the data, collecting the data, pasting them into the same file, etc. And this is where it's a very, maybe I would almost say, stupid task, getting Excel files into workable data, but it saves you so much time and it gives you so much advantage if you have the coding skills to do that, because a script can do it in 5 minutes, that really this is a step going from Excel to data that you can work with, that gives you the biggest advantage in a hospital, in a clinical setting. People know that data scientists spend 60% of their time just getting the data in the right format. So the faster you can do that, the really tremendous time gain there. And what is also important, and this is where the domain knowledge comes in, is that you do not only want to get the data into graphs, but you also want to give meaning to those graphs. And so this is a growth curve. For those of you who are not familiar with growth curves, the OD600 on the y-axis is a measure of how many bacteria I have, and on the y-axis we have the time, x-axis the time in hours. And typically you have a lag phase, an exponential phase, a plateau phase, and then you have a lysis, sometimes not. And all of those parameters of the growth curve are very important. So the maximum growth rate, the final biomass that is achieved, the start of the exponential phase, eh? So the length of the lag phase, etc. And people believe that if you have these characterized well enough, you can relate that to the infection rate of streptococci. So I will skip through this because of the time, and I will end with this slide over here. we measured all those data, we processed them, and at the end, we plotted, in this case, the final biomass, the final ODEI, as we measured them from the curves, and we plotted that out again in box plots for each serotype that we have for these pneumococci. And we see a tremendous difference, for example, between the characteristics for 50BC compared to a very virulent strain. Where is it? 19 over here. This is the one that is most found. So the research is still ongoing to make better this relation between growth phase and growth kinetics and infection rate. But already this analysis shows you a large effect of the growth kinetics based on the serotype. So going from a large set of Excel files, we had almost 1,000 Excel files, to a graph that people actually can make biological inferences from, is a very important step. I will skip this. This is scleroderma, very interesting, but I want to close by the last slide, how to become a data scientist. Slide 5, step 5, so to speak. I have I've described what the skill set is. I've shown you a few use cases. What now if you're enthusiastic and you want to work on it yourself and start doing data science? In my opinion and what I've seen around me, this is what really works very well. Ingredients for success, I would say. Always try to work on your own data, rather than on some data set that comes from the internet and that is not related to what you're familiar with. Work on your own data because you really are familiar with how you made them, and you're also motivated to work on your own data. So try to locate your own data to work with. And also work on a problem that is relevant for you. So don't try to do something because it can be done. Really define what it does for you. Does it speed up your flow chart? Does it save you a lot of time in processing Excel? Or does it give you the visualization that the physicians can make a diagnosis on? It doesn't matter, but really define the problem that you want to solve and work towards that end. This is, if you don't have this, it will not work. You really need to start here. And the next step is, and I said already, take a programming language, whether it's Python or R, it doesn't really matter. But you have to learn something in order to be able to do that. So you have to learn that. It's sometimes very frustrating. Don't give up at this stage. Steep learning curve, but it will pay off in the end. I'm sure of that. And this is important. Share and communicate your results, because you always get very nice input from other people. Start small with data handling, visualization, and after that go to the advanced statistics and artificial intelligence. Start small and think big in that respect. Okay, I'll stop here, and I'll unless there are any questions, but I think we should first give the floor to Mark before improve the time.
Thank you, Wieland, for the very interesting presentation. I think I'm not sure if there are any urgent questions from other people, but there was one question on the on what the education of analysts to data science looks like, but Mark already responded that he will touch upon that item, so he will go into that. Are there any questions that people want to ask now at this moment? I don't see any in the chat, and I don't see any hands going up. So if not, then for the sake of time, indeed, we move on to Mark, and maybe there are some questions at the end that we can answer. Yeah, so Mark, you can go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much, Peter.
My name is Mark Veldkamp. I work as a product manager of the IT Academy Noord-Nederland. I put my slides on. I see there's some strange transformation, but that doesn't matter for now. The IT Academy IT Academy Noord-Nederland is part of the Hanse University of Applied Sciences, the Institute of Communication, Media and IT. And yeah, we're working, we have a close collaboration with, for example, the Institute of Life Science and Technology, but also, for example, engineering. And we also have a close collaboration with the REG and also the Center of Information Technology of the REG. We were founded in 2014 by several organizations in the northern region of the Netherlands, in the region of Groningen. For example, also the UMCG. Someone is changing my slides. UMCG, REG, Hanse University, but also the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science. And they initiated the IT Academy because there was a shortage of IT professionals, but also a shortage of IT skills. And those organizations thought it was very important to have an institute in Groningen that is able to educate more IT professionals and retrain people on IT skill. So as an IT Academy, we provide education for professionals. For example, courses about programming, courses about IT security, security management, information management, agile, and that are a few examples of our range of courses. And our most popular course is our data science course. And that's a basic course which covers all the disciplines of covers all the areas of the data science discipline. And Wienand also mentioned a few things in his presentation. So important skills of statistics. Data mining is about pattern recognition and about some machine learning techniques. Python, and of course we use Python as a programming language, but you can also use R. Data engineering, very important because it's about data preparation to apply data science. Predictive model analysis and machine learning, Wienand also told you about it in his presentation. If you're very excited about programming, this September we start a new course, and that's about an introduction to computer science with Python. So you learn not only Python programming, but also maybe just as important about thinking like a computer scientist. It's more the problem solving skills. So this is the data science course is a basic course for data science, and this is our basic programming course, and both are relevant for also for analysts from the UMCG. But more important is if we look at data science for analysts. I talked with André about our course and about our educational programs. And we talked about how can we help you as an analyst to make the step towards data science, and how can the UMCG can help you to apply it in your work. And that's also the interactive part right now. Of course, we have ideas and examples of experience, but I'm very very curious about how can we help you to make the step towards data science. And now, because we are a great group, maybe it's good that if you have some ideas or some input, you put it in the chat and say it in the chat. And now, maybe if you want to know more about it, then we can give you the word by microphone. So if you have any ideas or questions or put something in the chat, and maybe we can talk about it.
Okay, thank you, Mark. I think one of the first questions that I would have, because I don't see anything appearing in the chat already, is one of the things that we not specifically said also in the end is work on your own data. How do you cope with that in your training? Because that makes your training also more difficult, because you don't know what people come up with as data.
Yeah, at the for our data science course, at the end of the course, we are closing the course with an end assignment. And for that assignment, you can bring your own data. And during the course, we also work with other data, our own data. But you can first apply it on the data of the course. But of course, then you also can apply those techniques on your own data. And it was a very good question, Peter, because if you look at IT, and if you look at programming or data science, you are learning by just doing it. Trial and error is very important in to gain knowledge about these techniques.
Yeah, in combination with starting where somebody else already left. So using the implementations that other people already did on the same topic, and trying to build on top of that. We see also that a lot of it is already available also in open source. So also digging into that can help. I see a question from Jos. So is there a good resource that tells us what to learn when it comes to statistics for data science, bioinformatics? I feel like I'm rusty. Also, don't know where to start. So, Wieland or Mark, do you have a good course that could be used?
So this is Wieland. What I learned, this is really personal, but what I learned a lot from is a very nice book. It's called Statistical Computing by Mr. Crawley, and it really starts very simple. And it takes you step by step through some very understandable statistical steps and transformations, and also gives you the R code, the computer code with it. So it's a kind of a textbook that you can follow along your own pace. I can send you the reference privately, or I don't know how we can communicate after this. But there are a few books that really can be used as a kind of a textbook for biomedical data science there.
Well, it might be interesting to, maybe you can now put it in the chat, or maybe Linda can also put it on the Dash website as extra content.
Yeah, I will look it up, and then I don't have it, and then put it in the chat.
There's also another question. Is it possible to make a course specific for UMCG analysts? I think that's one for Mark.
Yeah, of course it's possible, and because that's also why we ask for the input, because Andre and I, we talked talk about a sort of introduction, a data science course, especially for analysts, and with Wieland and some colleagues of Wieland, we have a lot of expertise
in our department. So it's definitely possible. And I also challenge you to bring up some subjects or some subjects you're learning up what you want to learn as an analyst when you want to start with data science.
That's a open call to everybody that's still online to come up with your ideas and what would you need as a analyst when you want to do data science, when you want to explore your data with these kinds of tools. There's one other question in the chat now. Can you also bring your own data and discuss with you what you can do with that data? So to explore what the next thing is that you could do with your data if you want to go beyond what you are normally doing to process your data to do analysis.
Yeah, I think that's also an idea of Wienand. So Wienand has experienced that. Maybe you can talk about your experience, Wienand.
Yeah, what we have done in the past in a different setting, not at the Hansa, but was to in fact organize these type of sessions, bring your own data, where you come with your data, with your question, and also with your results, how far you are up to then. And then you say, hey, I really want to know whether what I did is correct, or do you advise statistical tests, or do you know new visualizations that will shed new light on my data? And then we help you with that, not only with saying which visualization, but also if needed, coding those or pointing you towards the right R packages or Python libraries or give you examples from the literature. So that's very well possible.
Yeah, there came another chat message following up on that. That said, answer to that question, statistics. But in that answer, there was also a question because, yeah, what kind of tools are out there and what do they do? So is there a resource for that to know what kind of tools there are and what you can use them for?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Also good input. Just to get it clear, of course, have an idea how to make a course of data science for analysts, but we're also looking for some specific domain knowledge so we can put in the course. And I think the subject of tooling, there are a lot of tools available for data science, and yeah, of course we can show some tools in the in a training or in a workshop, or there are several ways. So, and we can also share some tools with Dash, so they can present it on their website.
Okay, I see that Wienand already put in the reference to the book. There's a remark from Heiner number two, probably because he logged in twice. And he says, we use a commercial program to do these type of statistics, Simca. Do you recommend to proceed with a tool like that, or is it better to let that go and start to learn R or Python?
That's an interesting track question. I would say both. Of course, you can use tooling for example, predictive modeling, but these tools are quite hard, and you need to put the data on their exact way in the program. And if you gain your own programming skills, you are able to preparate the data for data science in a good way, so you can do it yourself and you're not available, not dependent from tools. And if you look at the predictive modeling is a combination of applying statistics in combination with programming skills, but there are tools who can help you so that you with statistics. So it's both.
I think maybe to add to this, Mark, that there is a huge community on R and Python, and new packages come out every week that already do so much for the stuff that you need to do, that you can really build very powerful applications based on what is already out there. So for me, that is also a very big pro for these open source solutions.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think with that, we're going to close because it's 7:30. There are some other things coming into the chat, but we'll collect that also. I would like to thank Linda Baidelai, who helped us to set this all up and to organize this all. And I would like to end with telling you that we will have a next session next week. I'm not sure if I can get the slide on again. Let me see if that works. If we go to the first, so we have on May 19, we have a session in the morning on data science in practice for analysts. And there's also an email address set up. If we can go to, yes, ai.analisten@lc.umcg.nl. If you want to join the group or stay active or stay up to date on activities of data science and AI for analysts, then send an email and we'll put you in the mailing list. So that's it for this evening. Thank you all for attending, and I hope to see or hear you all next week in the second session. Good evening.
Thank you.